right, it's time for Tech Central. And of course, this is where we talk about technology and innovations and what Kenyans are doing to ensure that technology works to your benefit. This morning, I am joined by a gentleman who is known as Nicholas Kimali. Good morning and thank you for joining us.
Yeah, thank you.
I can see, and as you can see, there's a lot here. There's quite a number of things that he works on. And before we get to the actual products that you've come up with and solutions, technology-based, is this something that you've trained for? Is it something that you grew up wanting to do? How did you get into all this?
Okay, just to start off, I trained in electrical engineering at the University of Nairobi. Yeah, so I'm an electrical engineer by profession. And I have passion in electronics and basically embedded systems.
That is, well, what does that mean? What are embedded systems?
Okay, embedded systems means electronics that are smart.
Okay.
So you can program these electronics. You can actually have software that is running inside these electronics. Mm-hmm. So that's what I specialized in.
Okay.
Yeah, and I have been employed before. So when I cleared the university, I started off as an employee for a company that was designing tablets and point of sale terminals. So I did my first design, my first motherboard design after I cleared campus.
University. Mm-hmm.
Yes, and then after that, I went on to work at the University of Nairobi as a project manager for the Science and Technology Park, after which I worked as an engineer at IBM. But then again, I decided to go it by myself and just make products. And it's not just products, but it's problem solving.
Okay.
I don't like calling them just products, but it's
a problem that solve
a problem.
Exactly. And we'll come to that in just a bit. So you're more of an innovator as opposed to somebody who repairs things.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
I solve problems. I come up with solutions from scratch.
Okay. Yes. And this, which we are going to talk about here, have you done this solely? Have you done them individually? Or are they products that you possibly have, what would I call it, improved?
Okay. These ones, I would say it's a team. It's a team of guys. I wouldn't say that I've solely
designed them.
I'm the team leader for this group. But then again, it's something that we have done. We have actually put in a lot of research when it comes to problem solving. We use user-centered design kind of approach when it comes to designing our solutions.
Okay.
Yes.
So let's get into the products. Now, you have three main ones that you want to talk about.
Yes.
And the first one is Auto Bell School Management System. And if we can just look at this particular contraption that we started off the shot with, where you have, it's more like a signboard.
Yes.
There is a bell-looking thing there, and there's a contraption there. Run us through this. What is this?
Okay, so this is a... I'll call it an automated school bell system.
Mm-hmm.
But then again, it's not just a bell system, but it also has a component of school management system. So basically how it works, we have the control system, which is here.
Mm-hmm.
It's the control panel.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what happens is when we install this in a school, it is accompanied by a software, where the school administration is able to create the timetable, put it in the software, and then upload to the system.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what makes it smart?
What is it designed to do? What problem is it solving?
So this one, first, it solves the problem of bell ringing. Yeah, we know that there has been a problem. Mm-hmm. Actually, in most schools, there has to be that bell ringer.
And the bell ringer purely depends on remembering.
On remembering.
They have to remember, then look
exactly.
at the time.
Look at the time, they don't concentrate, and it's a problem in many schools.
Okay.
And sometimes, they forget, or maybe there's a harsh teacher in the class, and, they fear that the teacher will, do something wrong.
Mm.
So what happens is this alleviates that problem. And then again, to add on to that, it has a reminder. It has GSM technology. Mm. So what happens, 5 minutes before the lesson, it sends messages, SMS, to all the teachers that you are supposed to be in this class by this time.
Okay.
Yeah. So It actually reminds the teachers. If you are a teacher and you maybe forgot that you have a lesson, maybe in a certain class, it will automatically remind you.
Okay, and of course that is based on the software that they should have uploaded that now updates it.
Exactly.
Okay.
So that's what happens. And then to add on to that, this is just a module of the whole system. It's a big system. I couldn't have carried everything.
Understandable.
Yeah, so what happens, we have fingerprint readers that act as a...
Biometric?
As biometric. Mm-hmm. So that will act as a register when students come in. And then again, during
And that is still embedded in this system?
Yes, it's embedded
Meaning
in this
once
system.
Once a student is late based on their biometrics, the teacher would be able to tell.
Yes.
And I'm assuming this is something that even at the end of the term, you can maybe get like an analysis and print out.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah, and then again, to add on to that, during our research, we realized that some of the schools have a problem, actually not with the students, but with the teachers. Mm-hmm. So you find that a teacher would come in, would not come into class, but then again, they will give an assignment to the students.
They'll have registered as though they are in class.
Exactly.
Okay.
So this system is also able to curb that kind of a problem. Mm-hmm. So when you have biometrics, you know, you're able to identify all the teachers who come in. It's more of a login system. Mm-hmm. And then again, we have this display, which is an LED display. So this one is installed in all the classes. Mm-hmm. So in every class, before the bell rings, they will be able to see a notification what class is coming next. If it is mathematics class, if it is English, and then they will prepare. Mm-hmm. Yeah. In advance. That is 5 minutes.
That comes 5 minutes before.
Exactly.
But I guess you can also program it to show that display 10 minutes before. That's down to the school.
Yeah, that's down to the school. Okay. Because right now, what we've done is 5 minutes, mm-hmm. but it is it's something which is customizable mm-hmm. to the school. Because when they have the software, they can actually...
They can maneuver program what they want.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And then again, the good thing is for the whole system, it's wireless.
Wow.
So what happens when during installation, we just have to go to the class, find where there is electricity, mm-hmm. we just connect,
plug in.
Mm-hmm. But then again, we don't necessarily need to have the mains mm-hmm. because we have a solar system that supports
it. It can run
this.
The whole system.
It can run the
so
whole
that,
system.
So this can work even for exactly. schools maybe in the rural areas.
Yes.
Okay,
yes,
now question is, now that you have an SMS being sent to the teacher, you also have this display thing in front of the students. Doesn't that distract the lesson?
Okay, what happens, we have a setting. Actually, it's one of the questions that we got when we were doing our research. So we have some settings where you can disable the display during the class, and it will only come on like maybe 5 minutes
to winding
up the class, so that it notifies the students and also notifies the teachers. Maybe just before the show, you had
the alarm went off, and unfortunately, we're not able to program it now because that needed to have been done prior to
the show.
Okay.
But then again, you had the alarm giving a notification 5 minutes before 8:30, and then at 8:30.
And the alarm went off at 8:30.
Yeah, went off at 8:30.
Okay.
So that's how it's programmed. So when it gives that notification, then we program it so that the board can display. You have a mathematics class coming on.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Now, I'm sure most schools would probably want to know costs, estimates. Is it an expensive thing to invest in? Because if I look at it in terms of economies of scale, having a bell ringer is free.
Yeah.
The only thing is that the bell ringer
exactly.
is a disadvantage. And by the way, in some schools, being a bell ringer was a privilege. You had some privileges that came with it.
Yeah.
Is it cost effective?
Yeah, definitely it is. If you look at everything here, we did it locally. Mm-hmm. Actually, we did everything. We designed and we made it locally. Mm-hmm. And during our research still, we decided to have it modular. Because we realized in some schools, they may need some modules, but they may not need others.
Okay.
So for example, some schools may not need the displays, but they will just need the bell system.
So you can have one
without
the whole shebang. Okay.
Yes, so which will make it, which will lower the cost.
Okay.
And then again, if you want to add the display, mm-hmm. it also depends on the number of classes you have.
That you have.
Yes. So okay. because it's wireless, mm-hmm. we can configure it to have as many displays as you want.
Now, when you talk about it being yes. wireless, are you yeah. talking about it using internet or yes. is it just a wireless system that yeah. is free of internet?
Okay. It doesn't use internet, but it uses Wi-Fi technology and also radio frequency okay. technology. So what happens is in the school, there is a system in the software. So it logs into the Wi-Fi of the school. So we set up a Wi-Fi.
Okay, and then, uses that now to control
yes,
the whole.
Yes, it uses that one to control everything.
Okay,
yes.
Now Nicholas is one who has not just invented one thing, so he has several things. Let's go to number two. There's this Omata yes. speed limiter, and I can see yes. this written
actually,
Omata.
This
oh, this
one,
is
yeah.
the one. Eh? Yes. This is the actual Omata speed limiter.
Yes.
Is this a speed governor like we know it?
It's a speed governor.
Okay.
But then again, mm-hmm. it's a very, very smart speed governor.
Okay.
One thing that we know, in Kenya, the law just states that, you know, public service vehicles are not supposed to go past beyond 80 kilometers per hour. But then again, mm-hmm. if I may ask, if a vehicle is moving in CBD and mm-hmm. it's going 80 kilometers per hour, mm-hmm. isn't that overspeeding?
That's overspeeding.
That's overspeeding.
It's above the speed limit of that area.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. So what happened? We came up with this technology, mm-hmm. which has dynamic speed limiting. So this will automatically limit the vehicle according to the location that the vehicle is.
Okay.
So the map is actually embedded into the system.
When you talk about the map, you're talking about the Google yes. map that we use.
Yeah.
The is map there a specific map that you've designed for this?
Actually, it's more of Google map, mm-hmm. but it's more custom. You know,
okay.
when you talk of the map, mm. it's actually coordinates, more of coordinates.
Yes,
so
coordinates.
We have programmed everything mm-hmm. there. And then we can update it as we want.
Okay.
So we have an online portal where we just log into that portal, select a region, set the speed limit of that region, and we have a machine learning algorithm. So this particular system does not use a lot of data, as you know, smartphones
would require.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. So what happens is it has a machine learning algorithm mm-hmm. where it just updates which area and the vehicles that need to be updated, which are closer to that area.
Okay.
And
so,
then
mm-hmm.
yeah,
yeah, go on.
And then to add on that, we can do virtual speed bumps. So that means if a vehicle is moving and then we need to erect a speed bump somewhere, you just go onto the portal, click on that region, and erect.
When you say the speed bump, I'm thinking, is that speed bump coming up on the road, or
no.
is it just a system of controlling the speed such that when they get there,
yes.
they slow down?
Exactly. It's a
okay.
system for controlling the speed.
Okay.
Because that's why I've called it a virtual speed bump. It's not an actual speed bump, a physical one, but it's a virtual one. Because if I click on that region, then what happens is, if you're driving, you'll feel as if the vehicle is losing power, yeah, approaching that region.
Mm-hmm.
And then when you are past that region,
it
picks up
okay.
automatically.
Okay.
And then when you have these in your vehicle, you don't have to worry about overspeeding. Even in areas that are 50 kilometers per hour, mm-hmm. 30 kilometers per hour, because it will automatically limit you according
within that area.
Within that
How
area.
Does it pick yes. what areas to
yeah.
limit you in the speed limit? Because
yeah.
you may have a sign, for instance,
yes.
on Thika Road.
Yes.
There are parts which are 80 kilometers, there are others that are 50.
50.
Where does it get that information from?
So that information, it's something that we got first. We got some regions using our research team.
Mm-hmm.
So
it's pre-programmed.
Yeah, it's not pre-programmed because what happens, it can change. For example, we have some regions. Let me take a good example, Thika Road. It has regions for 50, 80, 100.
Yes.
Yeah, but then again, at some point, maybe they may change to 30 or something. So what will happen, we'll just go to our portal, just select that region, mm-hmm. and change the speed limit to 30.
Okay.
So all the speed limiters, actually our server will push that message to the speed limiters.
Now, where does this, where is the control coming from? Is it satellite?
Okay.
How does it reach from the server?
Yes.
And the other question that I was going to ask is, where are you controlling this from?
Yes.
And how does it come from the server to the
governor? Okay, what happens? This one has two main modules. There's one we call GPS, Global Positioning System.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have GPRS. GPRS is the one that you use to browse.
Mm.
So it's a cellular technology. So what happens is we get the location using GPS. And then for uploading the data, for actually talking to the server, it's as if you are browsing the internet. So this is actually browsing the internet, but then connecting to our server.
Okay.
So we are able to push that information using that connection.
All right, brilliant GPRS. Piece of information there. Yes. Now, we only have 2 minutes to go. Okay. You also have a smart tracker. What is that?
So a smart tracker is used for fleet management solutions. So if you have your vehicle, you need to know where your vehicle is. Real time, we have a solution for that.
Mm-hmm.
But then again, what makes it smart? One, it's not just a tracker like the one you see
the
everywhere.
Usual ones that we have
the
that
usual
are
ones
in the market. Yeah.
Exactly. This one, it can talk to other trackers, which are, you know, nearby.
Mm-hmm.
So it makes our guarantee go higher. The guarantee that we give to our clients is actually higher than even the trackers which are in the market.
Mm-hmm.
Because, okay, as we speak right now, we have a new one that we have developed
mm-hmm.
and is actually being manufactured in China as we speak. And that one, I tell you, we will be able to give even a 90% guarantee that if your vehicle gets stolen,
mm-hmm.
we are going to get it.
You're going to find it. Now, quick question before we wind up.
Yes.
Why is it being made in China when it's your brain that is doing this? Why not bring that business to Kenya? No wonder the 1 million jobs are not being realized.
Okay, perfect. Now, this is the thing. We design it. We have the capacity. Actually, in Kenya, we have very
brains.
Big brains. So designing everything, we do it in Kenya. And the only challenge that we have is in mass production. Because prototyping, we do it locally. But when it comes to mass production, there has been challenges. You know, China have perfected the art of mass production, and we cannot beat them in price.
Especially in terms of price.
Exactly.
Okay.
But then again, we have labs like the Gearbox, which has come up along Gong Road. We also have Fab Lab, which are helping us to, you know, do these things. And I know there is a push to have mass production in Kenya. And it will be of great benefit to us, so, since we wouldn't have to go to China to do these productions. And we will actually be producing everything.
All right. Thank you very much, Nicholas Kimali Mudhoka.
Yes.
Definitely a great innovator right there. And I wish you all the best with your projects.
Thank you so
We've not looked at the business side of it, but of course, that's something that I'm sure you're looking into.
Yes.
And Michelle, welcome back. And I hope you've absorbed all that technology.
I mean, this is amazing technology. I don't even know how someone would come up with this.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, you know, my dad used to say that everybody should benefit from the course that they have learned.
Yes.
So he's definitely making sure and taking advantage of everything that you have learned. Thank you very much, Mr.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
All right.